Thanks, Shauna. I hope you don't mind if I sit along with you, and I hope you also don't mind if I have some coffee. I don't think anyone's had coffee on stage this week, so I might as well be the first. It's been a very informative day, and with our focus shifting from yesterday's supply issues to focusing more on our end user consumers than I think we've ever had at Symposium before, it's been a great day, it's been a great symposium. So I'm here to bring you good news and bad news. The good news is that we're not in this alone, this being engaging our consumer base, our customers, our guests. There are others out there not working as specialty coffee professionals or companies, but who are helping to inform our consumer base, and in fact, even those who are not our consumers, the non-coffee drinkers, or as politicians might say, the soon-to-be coffee drinkers. The bad news is they have a voice of their own, and they have their own value propositions and their own constituencies to serve. I'm talking, of course, about the media. Writers, bloggers, TV producers, radio shows. I've had the privilege of being invited to be interviewed by some of those entities, National Public Radio, New York Times, Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, to talk about coffee within a range of different contexts. So it's my privilege to turn the tables on the media and ask them some questions for a change. So we have three panelists with us today who will meet one at a time. And rather than doing it here on stage, we decided that it would be more fun to travel to meet each one of our panelists while they're in their native habitats. Melissa Allison is on staff at the Seattle Times writing for the business section. We'll learn more about how she came to write about coffee today, but she brings an important and unique perspective as someone who writes about the coffee industry in Seattle. So therefore she has a certain persistent presence in the background of everything she writes.
Allison with the Seattle Times. I started writing about coffee several years ago when I was at the Seattle Times, and I'd been covering banking for a couple of years, and they said, oh, this was before the housing crisis, they said, banking's boring, we don't need any more of that, we need somebody to focus on Starbucks. So that's how I started writing about coffee. So I started writing about Starbucks like you would any company, and I was learning it like you would learn a big publicly traded retailer, and I realized that there was this entire coffee universe outside of Starbucks that I knew nothing about and that I wasn't getting to by just writing about them. So I started talking to the people in Seattle who were, you know, at Vivace or Zocca or the other independent coffee houses about what that world was like. That world was so different from Starbucks. I mean, these were people who talked almost exclusively about the flavor, who talked a lot more about sourcing. I mean, you know, when you're talking to Starbucks, you're having to talk to them about same store sales and a lot of corporate numbers, and they would talk about flavor. But when you're talking to somebody in an independent coffee house, from the barista to the owner of a roastery, they're all about the flavor and where they got this coffee and what their roasting profile is. And, you know, it's a more artisan conversation. The reason that coffee is important from a journalistic perspective, from a business journalism perspective, is that Starbucks has been a phenomenon that a lot of people couldn't grasp. They understood that it was happening. You know, I mean, when cities were waiting for Starbucks to come to their town or at some point to their highway rest stop or whatever, they were all excited, and yet nobody completely understood how that had happened. It was a brand new thing. This wasn't like covering Nordstrom or Macy's. This wasn't like covering McDonald's. This is covering like a completely new area of retail that Starbucks had forged in a big way. And so it was important to understand where that came from. I guess going to the coffee houses was my way of going to the roots of it, of figuring out why people loved it so much, why there was so much passion, and why there could be so much money behind it. So I'm used to writing for a business reader, right? Banking and airlines for all these years. And when I write about Starbucks, I feel like the traditional business readers are getting what they want. I mean, they want to know same store sales, they want to know strategy, what country are you going to next, and is it going to work out? Are you growing too fast? Things like that. The independent coffee house customers and baristas, that's a different story. I think it was an act of bravery for me to start the coffee blog. I knew going in that I had a really tough audience, people who didn't necessarily think I was covering things correctly. I didn't know what I was talking about, which, you know, was true, especially in the beginning. I was still learning. But to a large extent, didn't even think I had good motives. So I went in and I did it anyway because I wanted to learn a lot more. I don't even pretend to know a lot, but I wanted to learn a lot more about what was going on in coffee now. And I got a lot of flack at first. I'll say it was hard. But I think gradually, as I interacted with people who would complain to me directly, which I appreciated, they would understand that I was coming from at least an honest place, that I really was just trying to learn. And then they would help me, and that was great.
Please help me welcome our first panelist, Melissa Allison from Seattle Times. Melissa, what did you write that made people react, and how did they react?
Okay, well, my favorite story along these lines is when I first started the blog, I had written something about fair trade, and I forget what I had called it, but I'd gone over the top as far as the specialty coffee people were concerned, and Sprudge, I didn't know them at the time, ran this picture of me. I was the sea monster bringing down the galleon of Seattle coffee. And I was mortified. I mean, I laughed on Twitter. I acted like I had a sense of humor about it, but I was really mortified. I thought, wow, did I get it that wrong? Is fair trade really awful? And of course, I eventually got to know Zachary and Jordan and other people.
And they got to know you too.
Yeah. And I learned that they were talking about direct trade, and they wanted me to know more about direct trade and not act like fair trade was the end all be all. So that's what that was about.
And what else happened? I mean, was it mostly that, or?
Because
you mentioned in our video piece, some of the coffee sort of aficionados in Seattle also took things a little personally.
Yeah, I can't think of other examples of, there were ways that I would write things that would, you know, they didn't care what I wrote about Starbucks, but when I would write about specialty coffee, which I would try to do daily on my blog, there were ways I would phrase things that would upset them, and they'd make fun of me on Twitter. So, you know, I started following them on Twitter, and they weren't calling me out by my Twitter handle. They were just talking about it among themselves.
Oh, passive-aggressive, maybe?
Like Seattle a little. Yeah, so... So I figured out what they were talking about and, you know, tried to improve.
Right. Well, let's go ahead and introduce our next panelist. Julie Wolfson is a new media journalist based out of Los Angeles. She writes primarily for web publications, each with its own focus. So we'll roll the video.
Working all day for a mean little man with a clip on tie and a rub on tan. He's got me running around the office like a dog around a track. When I get back home, you're always there to rub my back. Hey, Julie, look what they're doing to me. Trying to trip me up, trying to wear me down. Julie, I swear it's so hard to bear it, and I'd never make it through without you around. No, I'd never make it through.
My name's Julie Wolfson. I'm a freelance writer. I focus mostly on lifestyle, pop culture, and travel, and lately a lot of food and beverage topics. And especially been learning a lot about scotch and whiskey and about coffee lately. Mostly lately, I've spent my time writing for Cool Hunting. I also contribute to Tube Filter about web television, CBS for travel stories about Los Angeles. I write for KCET, the public television station, for their food department. I just wrote an article for Spencer Magazine and am asked pretty often to contribute to other websites and online magazines. Well, when I write a travel story, I feel like a lot of times we have readers who are saying, okay, I'm coming to this city, where should I have a cocktail, or where should I stay, what should I do? So one of the things that I know that people are interested in is if they like drinking coffee, knowing where to go. So recently for CBS, I did a story of where to drink specialty coffee in LA and gave people a good map of some of the best places from downtown to West LA. And our readers also like to tell me the places that I missed, which is a great dialogue to have. In terms of Cool Hunting, they're very interested in artisanal foods, people who make specialty foods, and there's just a lot of coffee drinkers that work for the company. So as we hear about new companies and they have great coffee, interesting packaging, beautiful coffee bars, it's just become one of the topics on our website. Why coffee? Well, I was always a fan of coffee and I was always interested, and I've been a longtime customer of some of the good coffee bars like Intelligentsia. But more recently, my editors at Cool Hunting sent me to Intelligentsia's Extraordinary Coffee Workshop, kind of shot me right into the center of what I felt like was interesting about the coffee world and starting to meet the growers and roasters and starting to meet people from other companies after that. So it just kind of feel like I just was shot down the specialty coffee rabbit hole and ended up here. In regards to Cool Hunting, they're really interested in the best product. But beyond the best product, they need to have a visual story. It's a very visually focused website. So as much as we love the text and we love the story, they want to see the product. So first of all, we taste everything and make sure it's a delicious, wonderful, good version of whatever product it is, in this case, coffee. Second, we want to have some visuals. So lately, we've been really interested in pictures from the farm, pictures of the roaster, pictures of a probat, all these pictures of a siphon, all these things that are the visuals that are associated with it and the people associated with it. And I would say the next level is the packaging, the branding, and that it's just, we're interested in design. And at that level, if there's beautiful packaging, great branding, and interesting story on the visual level, that that's interesting to us too. But we want to make sure that we're not just looking at the branding and then finding out that the person doesn't have very good coffee beans inside.
Help me welcome Julie Wolfson. Julie, so you're in Los Angeles.
Yes.
And for a lot of us who pay attention to these things, LA is known as a pretty hot place for specialty coffee right now. Why do you think, what is it about LA that makes it special in that way, do you think?
Well, I feel like the artisanal food movement has taken hold in, it's grasped everybody, and people are in this fervor of eating and drinking and documenting their eating and drinking. And more I hear people shifting their conversations from food and cocktails to where are you drinking coffee, who has the best coffee, lots of debates about the baristas, the coffee bars, what's the best. And I just hear that conversation more and more in the city. And it's just the kind of city where it's pretty easy to overhear what everyone's talking about.
Right, right. So. And you mentioned in the video, a lot of the focus for you is on design. And this whole sort of new design and the internet sort of coverage of it, and especially coffee industry, those coming together in this way is a relatively new phenomenon. Why do you think that is? What is it about the focus for you for Cool Hunting and for maybe the consumer base that you reach?
Well, as I mentioned in the video, Cool Hunting is very visually designed, but we never want to get caught covering something because it's pretty and then find out that what we were covering was actually not a quality product. But in terms of design, it's interesting. After all the levels of getting good coffee beans into a bar and the barista making it into a cup, if on top of it, these companies are now building beautiful coffee bars designed by interesting designers and great spaces to hang out, it just becomes part of the story.
Right, and it becomes a design story as well as...
Yeah, I mean, I happen to be lucky enough to follow the team at Handsome Roasters from construction all the way through opening night, and now I'm a regular customer. And I interviewed Nathaniel, who built the space from Woodsmith, and it was really interesting how much the boys were having this kind of powwow of creating that sort of utopian coffee bar and every little detail of every material. And it was just part of their story. It doesn't mean everyone has to have that story. It was just what they were doing, and they built a beautiful coffee bar.
Right, right. Okay, well, our last panelist is Oliver Strand. Oliver lives in New York City and writes for the New York Times, the New York Times Magazine, for Bon Appetit magazine, GQ magazine, among other publications.
Hey, write about coffee from the point of view of a journalist at the New York Times, which is to say I write for the readership. I want to be as accurate as possible, as evocative and descriptive as possible, so that should the reader go to a coffee shop I've been to or try a coffee that I've tried, everything will be true to their experience. So that my experience and what I write about lines up with the reader's experience. Ultimately, I write for the reader. I mean, I can step back a little bit. I think that there are a lot of stories within the coffee industry that the coffee industry finds fascinating that don't necessarily resonate with the readership or with the editors. Just because an industry likes a topic doesn't mean it's going to appear in print in a general interest publication like the New York Times or GQ or Bon Appetit. So that's the first thing, you know. Not everybody's intrigued by the same topics. The origin, the subject of origin is interesting because it's intrinsic to the story of coffee right now. I haven't written about it because as a journalist, I need to gather information myself. I need for it to be a first-hand experience. I need for the interviews to be interviews that I conduct. I need for statistics to come from primary sources and not from secondary sources. So I know that the coffee industry really wants for this story to be told, but until you have a journalist on the ground who can really assess it, you're talking about secondhand information. Secondhand information is cloudy, and at times there is misinformation. The misinformation at times is accidental because something might not be well understood by a person in the coffee industry, and at times it might be intentional because a person in the coffee industry wants to put a spin on a story. So to use secondhand information to write about origin, I think, would be a tremendous mistake, and not anything that I would ever do. I think that coffee's incredibly unusual as a product because the social story is important to the consumer in a way that I don't see reflected in pretty much any other gastronomic product. We like the story of wine, but you don't talk about the state of the education of the children of the wine pickers. And that is a part of the story of coffee. And I think that's very interesting how that resonates. So direct trade is very important. Fair trade is important. Organic is important. These signifiers mean a lot to consumers. Pulling apart these signifiers and describing them, understanding what goes into them, and actually making an assessment of the value of these is an enormous undertaking that I don't think has been done well yet. And in order to pull these apart, you're talking about a lot of research, a lot of resources, a lot of time, and a lot of effort. I think that what's been most interesting and most challenging about writing about the coffee industry is the industry has taken what is a very complicated product and has made it more complicated. And most other industries take very complicated products and make them simple in terms of perception, in terms of understanding. You know, the iPad is incredibly complicated, but the story of the iPad, the narrative of the iPad is very easy. Wine is incredibly complicated, but the story and the narrative is very easy. In the case of wine, it's tasty. It can be really tasty, and when you drink it, you have fun. And you can talk about that. And with coffee, I find that nobody's satisfied with the coverage of coffee, no matter how much depth you get into, because there's more to it. That's true for every industry, every topic, every subject, every profession in the world. It's not just coffee, but the frustration expressed by the coffee industry at coffee coverage, I find really interesting and very entertaining. Because there's this undying desire to make the coverage even more complicated and intricate and detailed, as opposed to making it more simple, I'll just say it, and more fun. Just make it more fun. It's fun. Coffee's fun. But the coffee industry seems to be unhappy being told that coffee's fun.
Ladies and gentlemen, Oliver Strand. So there you go, very New York of you to sit back and just laugh at us all. Ha ha ha. But no, really, now there are a lot of people in the audience right now that are listening to you speak and that characterization and maybe don't relate to that because we're talking about a certain segment of the coffee industry. What are you talking about here? Who are you talking about?
Well, I guess I'm talking about specialty coffee, and then the question is, you know, what's specialty coffee? There is a little bit of a fishbowl effect, and you know, you talk about Sprudge and Twitter, and you know, is this a community of a few thousand people, or tens of thousands of people, or hundreds of thousands of people? It's really kind of hard to say. So yeah, I guess what I'm talking about is the people in the industry, a lot of the people in this room, a lot of the people who follow the people in this room on Twitter. You know, there's some kind of a connection there, a familial connection. Yeah, so the insiders, and I think what's important in terms of what I do, and I think also what everybody else up here does, is that we really don't write for your benefit. Like, we don't write for you. I don't work for you. I work for my editors, and we're responsible to the readers, and so we have a totally different audience. So what the job is that I have is to take your story or aspects of your story and to relate it to this readership. It's not to attend to your sense of yourself.
We'll get more into those topics, I think. Thanks. I think when you were getting into a lot of that stuff in the video, I saw a lot of nodding heads for sure. So it's pretty, I think it's profound and a little embarrassing. But anyway, so we'll get more into those topics, I think, as our time goes on. But how did you get started writing about coffee in the first place?
Well, I write about food for a variety of publications. I write often for the New York Times. And as a part of that beat, as a part of the food beat, I started to write about coffee. So that's how I came at it. I went to college at Berkeley in the 90s, so of course when I started to write about coffee, I already knew everything about coffee because, you know.
See, you're one of us.
Yeah, so I'm totally one of you. And it was interesting and humbling to get into this segment, or this art or discipline. Because I approached it like every other dining story. I mean, when I interview a chef or if I interview a supplier or I pursue a story, I assume that that person knows a lot and I should ask questions and that person's the expert. And that's how I started to write about coffee. And I think that stood out at the Times. I mean, other people were writing about coffee at the Times as well, before me and other than me. But we assume that the professionals are experts and they have some kind of insight and that we should speak with them and report what they say. And I think that a lot of coffee coverage in the past has been has been anecdotal and a little mean. You know, it's that you speak to a person, then you make fun of what that person says. Mm. So to me, it was just straight up, it was a dining story, it's dining journalism.
What's interesting is that you sort of showed up to us on the coffee scene side of things. Right at the tail end of when all anyone ever wanted to ask about was Starbucks or latte art. Mm-hmm. Like, those are the two things that if you worked in coffee or you were a barista, and you'll hear from a lot of the baristas as well, that it was sort of this annoying thing, that it was like the same things. But then, mm-hmm. you know, right around a couple years ago, things started getting more interesting, more nuanced, but I hear you on the constant dissatisfaction. But round of applause for our full panel. Please welcome here.